as far as he's concerned. And as far as I'm concerned, it's just an algorithm for generating all the theorems you can prove, right? And it's an algorithm that goes on forever. And the precise definition of the algorithmic information content of the formal axiomatic theory is the size in bits of the program that runs through all possible proofs, checking which ones are correct, the tree of all possible deductions from the axioms, using the symbolic logic you're using, producing all the truths, all the provable theorems. You see, it's a calculation that never ends. And the program wouldn't be terribly long. So the moment you have a bit string that's generated at random by tossing independent tosses of a fair coin, if it's substantially larger in bits than the algorithmic formulation of the kind I just told you, of the formal axiomatic theory you're using to try to prove that this bit string is algorithmically irreducible, you can prove it's impossible. It's not, it's just impossible to prove. It's a Berry paradox kind of argument that with n bits of axioms, you can't prove that anything needs substantially more than n bits to be calculated. You can't give individual examples.
And you can prove that it's impossible? You can prove that the probability of it goes to zero?
No, no, it's not the probability goes to zero. The probability is zero. You can't prove with a formal axiomatic theory that is n bits in the sense that I said that the algorithm that runs through all possible proofs, finding all the theorems, is an n-bit algorithm, then you can't give an individual example of any finite object that needs more than that number of bits to be calculated. So this is the theorem that David Wolpert mentioned.
Right.
So these bounds are actually apply to all possible formal axiomatic theories for which there's an algorithm to run through all possible proofs and get all the theorems. And Gödel's original proof applies only to Peano arithmetic, you see. But already starting with Turing's paper of 1936, there's a more general approach that then Emil Post captured and worked on, and I'm following that approach. So these are pretty general incompleteness results. So in other words, if you want an individual, even though most bit strings are algorithmically irreducible, if the string is longer than the number of bits that it takes to formulate your axiomatic theory, you're never going to be able to prove that an individual string that has more bits than the number of bits in your theory is algorithmically irreducible.
So your theorem doesn't rely on Peano arithmetic?
No, it applies to any formal axiomatic theory that is, algorithmic, for which there's an algorithm to check if a proof is correct or not, that it's a mechanical procedure to check if a proof is correct or not, which implies that there's a mechanical procedure to generate all the theorems, all the consequences of the axioms. It's very slow. This algorithm would be very slow because you're running through the tree of all possible deductions from the axioms, but it would include every result that can be proven within your formal axiomatic theory. And Hilbert thought there would be one for all of math that mathematicians could agree on, and that would be a very concrete proof that mathematics provides, absolute certainty that it's black or white, which is what most mathematicians assumed until Gödel. So this is a very general incompleteness result. So there are three sort of formulations of this that are roughly equivalent. One is that if you toss a coin, independent tosses of a fair coin, a number of times that's substantially larger than the bits of axioms of your formal axiomatic theory, you're not going to, even though it's extremely likely that this will give you an algorithmically irreducible, unstructured random string, you won't be able to prove it from those axioms because there's more information in the random string than there is in the axioms you're trying to use to prove that it's random. Now, another version of the result is you can't prove lower bounds. You can't exhibit any individual example of an object with an n-bit formal axiomatic theory. You can't exhibit any particular finite object, a given specific example of an object which provably requires to be calculated a program that is substantially larger than the number of bits of axioms in your formal axiomatic theory. Okay, now I'm saying substantially, which is a little messy detail, but in the mathematics, there's a sharper formulation. I like to talk about elegant programs. You're fixing the programming language. An elegant program is one that has the property that no smaller program in the same language produces the same output. Okay, that's the most concise program in that particular programming language that produces the output that it does, okay? And here you get a very sharp result. If you want to prove that a program is elegant that has more than n bits, you need a formal axiomatic theory that has n bits. Otherwise, you can't prove it. You can't exhibit any object that is provably requires more than n bits if you have an n-bit theory. Yeah, there's a proof for this. I don't know if I should get into the proof.
No, don't worry about the proof. It's going to be difficult to convey with words.
Okay. The proof is very simple, but
okay, if you can.
I would need a blackboard probably to explain it better. This is a very simple result compared to Gödel's incompleteness theorem. The proof is really very, very simple. So these are three different versions of essentially the same idea formulated in slightly different ways. The proof uses something called the Berry paradox.
Uh-huh.
You see, because if I could prove that a specific object requires very big programs, and I'm proving this from a smaller number of bits, I can run through all the proofs in your formal axiomatic theory until I find the first object that provably requires a lot more bits than in your theory. And then what's happened is I've calculated that object, which supposedly needs a very large program, but I've calculated from a much smaller number of bits, which is the number of bits in your theory.
Yeah.
You see? The proof is very, very simple. Now, as Grothendieck said, when you really understand something, the proof should be very short and very simple. So this, I think, but this is a different kind of incompleteness result than Gödel's. It's rather different in character. Now, starting from this, there is something called the halting probability, the omega number. It's a real number. It's a probability. It's between 0 and 1. You know, 0 would be no computer program halts. You generate computer programs at random, and 1 would be every computer program halts. And of course, the answer is somewhere in the middle. And if you write this number in binary, it is algorithmically irreducible. All the initial segments have very high complexity. It looks totally unstructured. It's incompressible. It's a number defined in pure mathematics that really cannot be distinguished from independent tosses of a fair coin. So in the world of pure mathematics, where truth is assumed to be black or white, you have something that is a very good simulation of randomness, of independent tosses of a fair coin in pure mathematics. So this is a sort of a worst case. You see, the original idea of Hilbert was that all of math, he wanted a theory of everything for all of math that all mathematicians could agree on, you know, because there were paradoxes and controversies about how to do math. And Hilbert proposed that formalism was a good way to clarify this. And so his idea was that all of mathematical truth, all of the infinite, there were a theory of everything for all of math, all of mathematical truth, this infinite amount of mathematical results in the Platonic world of mathematics, of pure mathematics, could be compressed into a finite set of axioms and rules of inference, right? Now, the halting probability omega is the opposite extreme. It's this infinite amount of information. It's a real number with an infinite number of bits, which is incompressible. It looks totally unstructured. If you want to determine the first n bits of the numerical value of the halting probability, you need an n-bit theory. If you want a computer program that will output the first n bits of the halting probability, you need a computer program that is n bits long. And similarly, if you want to prove what the bits are, you would need n bits of axioms and rules of inference to be able to determine n bits of the halting probability. So the halting probability is a sort of a worst case. It's a case where mathematical truth is completely irreducible. So it's the opposite extreme from Hilbert's idea of a theory of everything, which would be a finite amount of information, a finite set of axioms, a theory of everything would be a finite set of axioms and rules of inference that would give you all the infinite world of Platonic ideas, all the provable results. And here is a case of an example which is the exact opposite, where you have an infinite amount of mathematical information that can't be compressed at all, you see. So this is sort of, as a physicist friend of mine told me, Carl Sposi, this is sort of a nightmare for the rational mind, because it's the opposite extreme from what Hilbert thought was going to be the case in pure math. It's something that's completely irreducible, incompressible mathematical information. You see, because this halting probability can be defined more precisely, and then it's a specific real number, and its value is determined by its definition when you go through all the work of...
Have you heard of finitism?
Finitism is the idea that the world of mathematics, you shouldn't allow infinite things in the world of mathematics, right? Yeah, well, I've heard of it, and it's a, you know, it's certainly a defendable point of view, but it destroys a lot of beautiful mathematics. You know, mathematics is, I don't know how to put it, it's a sort of a fake world, maybe. Part of the problem with finitism is where do you cut the line? You know, how big is too big? You know, it's a sort of where do you put the wall? But you see, for example, there's a very simple proof that there are infinitely many prime numbers, right? That goes back to ancient Greece. And there you have infinity already, you know, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So mathematically, I agree that in our daily lives, we don't see infinity anywhere, right? Or maybe if you're religious, you think that God is infinite. But we're certainly not infinite, we human beings. But but you can prove things about infinity in pure mathematics. That's part of the beauty of it, that this is this Platonic world of mathematical ideas. Even the simplest math, which is just 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, addition and multiplication, you know, where you talk about numbers that are composite or prime, you have some very simple, beautiful proofs. The standard example that G.H. Hardy gives in his lovely little book called A Mathematician's Apology, when I was a student, it seemed lovely to me. I was reading it not that long after Hardy had written it. Mm-hmm. He wrote it during the Second World War to cheer himself up. He was a pacifist. Well, you didn't have to be a pacifist to be very sad about what was going on in Europe during the Second World War. So he wrote this little book called A Mathematician's Apology. He's apologizing in the end a little aggressively for the fact that he likes pure mathematics, mathematics that has no applications. He's thinking of applications to war and destruction, right, in the middle of a war. And he says one field of math which will never have its hands with blood is number theory or arithmetic, where you talk about prime numbers, for example, and prove they're infinitely many. Historically, that hasn't quite been the case because number theory is used in some schemes for cryptography, prime numbers and factorization. So probably Hardy would be unhappy about those practical applications of...
Sorry, that was the First World War or the Second?
This was the Second World War.
Yeah, because the Germans were already working on the Enigma machine at the time.
Yeah, but nobody knew about it. Hardy was doing pure mathematics at Cambridge. He was, of course, very sad because his students mostly went to war, right? And many of them didn't come back from the war. I'm not sure if this is when he had Ramanujan there. Mm-hmm. Ramanujan was a foreign national, so he wouldn't have been called into the armed forces. And maybe some of the students at Cambridge would have been upset that he wasn't fighting for England. But at that time, India was part of the Commonwealth, so I'm not sure how this all plays out. Anyway,
how is a theory of everything in physics different than a theory of everything in math?
Well, in theory of everything in math, from Gödel in 1931, we know isn't possible. Now, in physics, I think that a lot of physicists still hope to have a theory of everything for the physical world. But if the physical world doesn't contain infinity, then you don't get incompleteness results, for example. So Gödel's incompleteness theorem, as far as I can see, does not translate directly into saying there can't be a theory of everything for physics. Mm-hmm. For example, the halting problem Turing's halting problem, which I love because my own work comes from Turing's work more than from Gödel's, is not realistic from the point of view of physics, because you're talking about unbounded or infinite time of computation. You're asking if something, if an algorithm will halt in a finite amount of time, but it can be an absolutely monstrous amount of time. So this is, I think, unrealistic from the point of view of physics. So I don't think these mathematical results, in my opinion, translate, that say that there is no theory of everything for pure math, translate into saying there's no theory of everything for theoretical physics, unless you maintain that the world of mathematics is a subset of the physical world.
If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.